It is a great honor and a privilege to introduce Devorah Marson. Your maiden name was Laufer.
Yeah.
And we hear your beautiful home in Amsterdam. And thank you so much for inviting me into your home. And if you could relate the most amazing story of your family and how you survived against all odds.
Yeah. Now, before I start my story, I want to give a big schoolig to you, Les Glassman, because it's so important, the work you are doing. We are the last generation, and the world should know what happened. And you know, in Israel, they have their own war, and they don't know so much about the Second World War. And you know, it's a tremendous, it's very, very important, and it's a big mitzvah what you are doing. You know, years ago I met Elie Wiesel. Yeah, Elie Wiesel. And he used to say, if we stop talking about the war, it is as if we murder them again. 6 millions of Jews were killed. And we have to continue telling more and more, and every day we speak about the war, because it's such a mess that I'm still alive. I was 2 years when we came to Ravensbrück, and today I have two wonderful daughters, Bli Einora. I have grandchildren, I have great-grandchildren. That's a triumph on Hitler. Je mag je maar. And I speak in schools and I speak for the Goyim, but it's never, never enough. So therefore, I thank you, and may HaKadosh Baruch Hu bless you for long, long life for this important work, what you are doing.
Devorah, I'm honored. I'm honored. But it's the greatest chut, it's the greatest honor and privilege.
Yeah, but thank you very much. Well, if I start talking about the war, I must say that my parents never gave us a trauma, because, you know, for example, my mother never wanted to talk about the war, but my father had the desire to tell all the stories, and therefore he told everything to Tzvi, my brother. But my mother wanted, you know, to look forward and not to look backward. But never, when she was old, she got Alzheimer, and then the war came in, you know, tremendous. She was sitting in the chair, shivering, they're coming to catch us, like this, you know. And that was really hard for us. But I start from the beginning. My father came from Hungary, from a very, very poor town, Joka. And for his bar mitzvah, he got, you know, can you imagine, an egg, that was his present, and an aliyah issue. They were so poor that in the night he couldn't sleep from the hunger. And after his bar mitzvah, his parents sent him to Bratislava, and he went there to a yeshiva, and he learned there to be a Führer. And what his eyes saw, his hands could make. He had a great, great talent. And his teacher, Mr. Kövery, told him, go to Europe, because here you have no future, no Parnosa, and start a business over there. So my father came to Holland beerg in 1928, and he started first in Amsterdam, and then he went to Rotterdam. He built up a beautiful business, and on Shabbat he went to eat in a kosher restaurant. And my mother, who lost her parents in a young age, she also went with her sister Johanna also to eat there. And the owner of the restaurant wanted to put the young together for a shidduch, so he put my father next to my mother, and my mother asked, is Yoka famous of? And my father said, well, the dogs are walking without shoes.
Ducks, not dogs.
And so my mother started to laugh. The ice was broken, they fell in love, and they married in 38. And then Gisela, the oldest sister, was born in 1939. Anyway, and then Marguerite was born, but in 1940, we were living in Rotterdam, the whole town was bombed down. My father lost everything. He had a beautiful shop, they had a very nice house, they got a lot of presents for the gastenaar. They lost everything. And what I show you, a picture, wacht even, like, zoek jij dat is van de gastenaar. And Mr. and Mrs. Cohn took them in their house, and there my father started again a little business, you know. And because my father was a very charming, nice looking man, the women of Rotterdam liked to buy by him their coats. Look, this is a wedding picture of my parents. Can you see it? And this is Mr. and Mrs. Cohn, who took my parents in their house after they lost everything. You see that picture? Okay. And my father started a new business, but the life in Rotterdam became more and more difficult because of the war. And then my mother got an arrest that she should go to Westerbork with Gisela and Marguerite. But I was only half a year old and they didn't registrate me. You understand? So my father went to his friend, Dr. Elsass, and he asked him, maybe you take me in your hospital and I can hide there. So Dr. Elsa said, we say that, but we have to do something. I don't know whom I can trust for my employees. So drink a glass of blood. You are going to vomit. Then I can write down that you have an ulcer, a maag bloeding. How do you say?
An
ulcer.
Yeah, an ulcer. And then he took my father in the hospital in order to hide. And my mother put me as a baby in a blanket. She went to the neighbors and she begged, bring this little baby to my husband. He's in that and that hospital, and tell them that she has got a children illness, which is very
contagious.
And that's what she did. And you know, that was very, very dangerous. Imagine if I would have started crying, she would have been shot on the spot. So the lady went to the hospital and we were there for 3 months. But then Dr. Elsa said, it's getting much too much danger. I'm going to send you to Amsterdam. And we were there again in 3 months in a hospital. And then my father went to look for a house. And Amsterdam was already empty. All the Jews were taken away because of the razzias. So it was very easy to find a house. And he looked after me for 9 months. Imagine. And then he did something, you know, my father was a hero. He went to the headquarters of the SS in Den Haag. It's called the Oranje Hotel. And he went there in, saluted, I'm a Jew, I'm from Hungary. You are not allowed to take my wife and my children from me. I insist my wife and my two children back. Can you imagine that you go in the headquarters of the Nazis and say, I'm a Jew and I want my wife back? But they were so impressed, you know, that he was such a hero. And you won't believe it. Next day, my mother came back from Westerbork with my two sisters. And that was amazing. Nobody ever did this. But, you know, my mother was the whole day crying because the town was empty.
Yeah, you should show this.
He had papers.
He has a paper here. Here it says terug, you see. Terug means back. He was sent back. His wife and two little daughters came back because Hungary was still neutral with Germany. And that's why he said they didn't have the right to take my grandmother with her daughters to Westerbork, and he came back to Amsterdam.
Amazing, no? Amazing. So that's already a Nes Mina Shomayim, but my mother was the whole day crying because the town was empty. And she said, I'd rather go back to my own people, to Westerbork. What am I doing here? But there came somebody from the illegale, how do you call it?
The hiding. Illegal.
Yeah, and he offered my mother a place for the three daughters of Laufer. But my mother said, no, I'm not giving my children away. Where I go, I take them with them. But not realizing what she was saying, you know. She didn't know what was waiting for her. So, but because my father looked after me all the time, I was scared of my mother. I started to cry. Only my father was allowed to dress me, to feed me. My mother, you know, I didn't know her. So, okay, we came back to Westerbork. And then my father was taken to Buchenwald and my mother with three little girls to Ravensbrück. Can you imagine, as a baby of 2.5 years old, coming to Ravensbrück, it's such a Nes that I'm still alive, that my whole life I feel, what was the reason that HaKadosh Baruch Hu saved me? That must be with a reason. I have to do something with my life, because if 6 million of Jews were slaughtered, murdered, gassed, you know, and we are still alive, there must be a reason for that. Because, you know, my sisters always say, it can't be that you remember something. You were too small. But there are things, oh wait, you know, many people were already taken to Auschwitz, to Sobibor, all these horrible places, and we were one of the last to be taken. And my father was taken to Buchenwald because he was Hungarian, and the women of the Hungarian men were taken to Ravensbrück. But again, a Nes that we were in the latest transport. I can't explain. Everything is Midei Shamayim. And my sisters always say, it is impossible that you remember something. You were too small. But there are certain things which I'm sure that I remember, not by stories, but by myself. For example, there were big black dogs, police dogs, and they were always jumping on us. And I'm dead scared about black dogs, you know. And for example, in the age of 2.5, a child is always funny. That's one of the nicest times of a life of a child. So there was we were in Buchenwald, there were kapos, that were people whom they took from prison to look after the Jews. And they were terrible. They were smacking us and they were unbelievable. But there was one kapo, somehow she liked me, and my sisters were that scared. They realized already, and they sent me to Ganven sugar. And sugar, that was like gold, you know? And then I took the sugar and then divided with my sister. I made a play out of this, you know? And my mother used to tell me, I never slept next to her. I always walked around. And sometimes she was looking for me in the morning and found me next to somebody who died during the night. Imagine, a child, such a young child. How is it possible that I survived, you know? I was walking around, sucking my two fingers with a little napkin, called it my num-num, and we were always very quiet, as if we felt not to be, you know, not to be seen. We always were very, very quiet. It was an intuition to be calmed down. And you know, so many wonders. My sister got very ill. She got pneumonia, Marguerite, and she had high fever. My mother didn't know what to do. If I leave her in the camp, she will die without me. If I take her on appel, you know, the prisoners had to stand for hours. They were counting everybody. And she asked somebody, what shall I do? And she said, take her in your arms, the best. And because of the cold, the fever went down and she survived. Can you imagine what a wonder? It's amazing. And you know, Christmas, half a year before the end of the war, in Ravensbrück there were also
guest chambers.
How comes that we were not killed? It's always a question in my life, why were we the only survivors of Ravensbrück? I'm the youngest survivor. Can you imagine? And you know, half a year before the end of the war, all the children of Ravensbrück had to sing Christmas songs because the Germans were eating their Christmas meal in front of these children who were so hungry, and they had to go on singing. And my mother and her friend Frida Moskowitz said, no, this goes too far. And they hide us in an edge under the barrack, and the children of Ravensbrück were singing their Christmas songs. And at the end, the Germans left, and the children had to go on singing, and they put
gasoline,
and they put the whole barrack on fire. No child survived Ravensbrück. Can you imagine? It's unbelievable. And you know, actually, when started the war in my life? That started when I became a mother myself. Then the whole day I was thinking, how can it be? What did my mother do in order to survive? And she saved her own bread to feed us. Unbelievable, unbelievable. And you know, after the fire, there was a big panic, and they didn't even notice that we were still alive, and they put us to Bergen-Belsen. And the German wanted to wipe out all the cruelty what they did, so therefore we were sent to Bergen-Belsen. They didn't want for the history to know what all the things they did. And in Bergen-Belsen, it was also, my mother was already in coma. She was very ill, and she was thrown on a pile of meisim,
corpses.
And you know, Frida Moskowitz went and she said, you have to save this lady. She's the mother of three children. And that happened. They took her out of the pile, and they treated her and she survived. Don't ask how, but she survived. Again a wonder. And you know, in Bergen-Belsen, when the British came to rescue us, they gave us chocolate, white bread, milk, and Gisela, the oldest sister, who is very clever, she said, listen, Mama is dead, now I'm your mother, you have to listen to me, and you are not allowed to drink white water. She didn't know what is milk. She took that away from us, and the bread and the chocolate, and many, many children and people in Bergen-Belsen who were, you know, without food all this time, they started to eat too quickly and too heavy and too much, they died. That again, we were saved because of Gisela, you know. It's amazing. And in the meantime, my father was in Buchenwald working like crazy. He had to, you know, stump to take cables and put them together in the snow, very hard working. And my parents were so vroom. For example, my father, 3 times a day, he was davening, Shachris, Mincha, Maariv. And the other people in Buchenwald, they said, Willy, are you crazy? Where's this God of you? You are still davening? Look in what a hell we are living. And you are still davening? You are not normal. But my father used always to say, they can smack me. They can the most cruel things to do. But Yiddishkeit, they can't take that away. That's in my mind. Nobody ever can take away Yiddishkeit. And that's how my parents were educate us. When in your life there is some tragedy or a hard time, never lose hope. Always there is an Hashem, Lamala, and there will always be the end of the tunnel. And you know, my parents, when they came back, my father was 38 kilos in weight. He was like this. Like this, he was shivering. He couldn't keep his mouth together, so weak. But they were strong. They had emuna. They built up a business again. They built up a family. They built up the Kehila in Rotterdam. My mother was in the Chevre Kadisha. My father was the Gabbai in Shul. And we had an open house. My mother standaard cooked for 3 people extra, because Rotterdam was a harbor, a town where people were missing their aeroplane or their train. We had always guests. We had people who didn't have any family, they didn't know where to live. So everybody came to the Laufers, and we had a marvelous
childhood
actually. And we didn't have a trauma because of my parents, because they learned us, have respect to your neighbor fellow, whether he is black or a goy or a liberal or orthodox, no matter, you have to be an open house and welcome everybody and be friendly. And that's how I educate also my children. And Baruch Hashem, it's because of my parents, the Yiddishkeit is Baruch Hashem very strong in our family. And that's thanks to my parents. But when I got a mother myself, then started the trauma, you know? Because the whole day, when I hold my baby, I thought, how can it be that I was saved? How did my mother do that? And then I look at my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren, Bli Einora, I can't imagine that I survived. Unbelievable. And also my father, he had such a tough time in Buchenwald. He had to work like crazy. And there was one Nazi whom he said, you know what, I've been a rich man in Rotterdam. I make you my compagnon. You can ask everybody who was Willy Laufer before the war, and I'm going to make you a rich man. But we will write down a covenant that after the war you will be a rich man, but then you have to give me a little bit more bread. He made a sort of business, and the man made a contract, and he gave my father sometimes extra bread, and this fellow were killed in the war. He never came back, this Nazi. Can you imagine? So many stories we have, which is unbelievable, you know, that my father, for example, he had to walk from Buchenwald to Theresienstadt. Whoever could go on were killed on the spot. And my father was so weak, he was eating the grass of the ground, you know, and you know, at a certain moment, he was saying already, we do a Shema, he felt that that was the end, he couldn't anymore. And the husband of Frida Moshkowitz, who saved my mother, he took him on his shoulder, the last meters, to Theresienstadt. And you know what? When they arrived at Theresienstadt, there was there standing Rav Brotman, who later became a very famous Rav in Amsterdam. And he recognized my father. The first thing my father was asking, do you have tefillin for me and a talis? I want to say a bracha that I'm surviving this march. Unbelievable. Everybody would have asked a glass of water and some bread. No, they asked for a tefillin and a siddur and a talis in order to thank HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That's mashal, unbelievable. And you know, after the war, my father started again a business, and they worked like crazy, and when they were, and they even got more children, 3 more children. When the State of Israel was declared, my brother was born. And can you imagine, after 3 girls, there comes a stamhouder, a
prins.
A prins?
A prins.
Yeah. And that was 2. And Chazan Moshkowitz did his bris. And I remember we were having a suda, and everybody was crying, because Chazan Moshkowitz was singing Ich vor aheim. And I was thinking as a child of 5 or 6, oh, everybody is crying because my brother has so much blood and is hurting so much of the breeze. You know, these are things which you never forget in your life. And after the war, we were so ill, we had typhus and phlegtyphus. Gisela and Margalit were sent to Switzerland to recover. And I was too small and too ill. I was not allowed to come with. And I'm, until today, so beleidigd. I started crying for hours. I also wanted to go to Switzerland. And I know that, you know, like it was yesterday. I remember it. Like I was, you know, I was very offended that I was not taken away. And what I also remember, when I was very, very small, we had to go in this clothes, you know, hoe zeg je dat?
Striped
clothes. And I was thinking by the age of very, very young, later when I'm a big woman, I'm only going to wear very nice clothes. Never in my life am I going to wear schmatters. And I remember that, you know. And Gisela and Margalit, they say, that can't be that you remember, but I'm sure that I remember, you know. When you have traumas in your life, you put it here in your mind. But then, you know, after I got married and after I got a baby, I was the whole time thinking about Ravensbrück. And then I thought, you know, there is in Amsterdam a statue, and every year there is a remembrance of Ravensbrück. Zoek dat eens op. Dat moet hier tussen zitten. Hier. And I found my mother. Here, this is the statue of Ravensbrück. You see that picture? And I found my mother and said, we are the survivors of Ravensbrück. Let's go to this remembrance. And my mother said, oh no, stop about the war, I'm not going. So I went alone and I went to the director of the committee and I told him I'm one of the youngest survivors of Ravensbrück. And he looked at me like a genevish. He said, lady, impossible, no child came back from Ravensbrück. I said, but I'm the youngest survivor. He said, can't be, can't be. He thought that I have a duke in Kopf. So I went to Yad Vashem. I asked for the papers and I went there back. And now today I get the biggest honor because now they believe me because I can show the papers and I have to speak there and every year they put always flowers but I put near and a candle and they give me the most great honor because now today they believe me. But my whole life I had the feeling I must do something with my life. It can't be that I was saved and 6 million Jews were murdered. So what happened? I went to work in the community for 80 years as a social worker. And while I was working, my oldest grandson got a terrible accident. I don't want to go in details, but for half his body, he was completely burned. I'll show you a picture, he was 3 years. It was terrible, terrible, terrible. You see, that is Nafti Uri. And I was sitting there for weeks, for months. He had 40 operations, skin operations. And I was davening next to his bed. Please, Hashem, help me, save him. And if you save him, I made a neder. The rest of my life I will dedicate to ill children. And Baruch Hashem, today Nafti Uri is the father of 4 children. And look what a tzaddik. He dedicate a kidney to another person because there's a whole article about Nafti Uri. He said, I got a second life because I survived this accident and today I'm going to save somebody else. That's my tzaddik Nafti Uri. You see?
And he donated
a kidney.
You can read the article if you want.
Was it a kidney to somebody?
One and a half year ago by Matnat Chaim in Israel. By Harav Haber, and he didn't know the one he was receiving, but after the surgery he got to know him, and that today they are very close.
You can take the article and bring it to Tzvi, yeah, if you are in Israel. Give it to Tzvi.
You can read it online, I think. You can read it.
So, and then I went back to Holland after all his operations. And while I was in Israel, I met Chaim and Miri Erntal. And they lost their son Menachem after 16 years of fighting against leukemia. And I heard about them, and they made something out of tzoras. They made an amazing things. They got even a Pras Yisrael from Bibi Netanyahu. I was there. And what did they do? While Menachem was ill, the poor brothers and sisters at home, they didn't get enough attention. Everything was focused on Menachem. And then they built an amuta where not only the sick child is helping, but the whole family around. And today they have an amazing things. And I heard about them. And after Menachem died, I invited them to come to Holland. They were in love with Holland, such a beautiful country. And they said, Dvora, maybe you make a summer camp for the poor, ill children. I said, okay, I'll try. And I came home and my family said, ach, don't, you never have done this. You will disappoint them. Where do you get the money? Where do you get the hotel? That's impossible, you can't. And the more the people around me said, don't, the more I wanted it. And you know, I got then in that time a phone call from Israel, from a best friend. He said, Dvora, in Amsterdam happened a terrible accident. A Jewish boy, a tourist, fell in the water. It was bitterly cold, and with his car, he parked his car and he drove in the canal. And he's now in a coma, his family is there. Please go and help him. You are a social worker, go there. And I went there with Shosho, we helped the family. They were very primitive, they didn't speak English, not German. And we translated for the doctors. And we went there with breakfast, lunch, dinner. And we're schlepping every day, sitting there for hours. And the menahel of the hotel where the boy was working, he came every day to visit his employee. And after 3-4 days, he said, Dvora, did you know the boy before this accident? I said, no. He said, but why are you doing this? He said, I said to him, we Jews, we are all family. For this, you don't need to know somebody. That's a mitzvah. We called it a mitzvah. He said, you mean it? You know what? I'm very ill. I've got cancer. You don't see it on me, but I've not long to live. Do you know a mitzvah for me, maybe? I said, well, I have to think about it. He said, well, I'm going to, after 10 days, Avi, this boy, died. We called up the Chevra Kadisha and they were singing Tehillim next to his bed for hours. And this man, this non-Jewish man, he was so impressed. He said, I'm going to pay the funeral. I'm going to pay your ticket. You have to go and bury Avi in Israel. I said, no, for a mitzvah, you don't take any reward. Maybe on 120 years, maybe I get a reward. But here, no. The Chevra Kadisha is going to pay everything to Daraba, and maybe we'll see each other again. He said, yeah, here's my card. You have to think about a great mitzvah. And then in that week, I couldn't sleep. And like a voice from heaven, one night I couldn't sleep. Why don't you go to this man? He wants to do a mitzvah. So the next day I called him up. He said, Dvora, I'm so happy. Whatever you ask me, come to my hotel. You get it. And I told him, I need a hotel for 200 people for a week, for a holiday, for very, very ill children. He said, come with me in the car. I've got a castle, a hotel. It will be all yours. I close it for all the tourists. And this is your... So, mitzvah, koreret mitzvah. He came over Shabbos, this man. He was the whole Shabbos crying when he saw these ill children, and 2 months later he died. So that's how my work for Zichron Menachem started, because I thought if HaKadosh Baruch Hu sent me such a shaliach, then the rest will also succeed. And you know, next year Bezrat Hashem, they will come for the 10th time, a jubileum, because if you believe in it, you can. You have to believe it, and I wanted it. And you see, it happened. And that's how my work started, and this neder by Nafti Uri, I will do the rest, till the rest of my life, you know, because I've got a purpose in life. I'm not stum a survivor of the Holocaust. I have a goal in life, which therefore maybe I was saved. Maybe, you never know. And, you know, ben ik wat vergeten? Nee.
Shasha, can I ask, how do you feel, the daughter of, and the granddaughter of the most righteous and tzaddikim, the most unbelievable people. Your mother is unique.
And your
uncle and your aunt.
The whole family.
The whole family.
Yeah, but she is every day talking about the war. You have no idea. Not that she has got a trauma, but the war is every day in our life.
Yes.
No matter what dinner we have, and no matter who is coming to visit us, after 2 minutes, we are speaking about the war. When I'm together with my sisters, after 5 minutes, we are talking about the war. This is like a red thread through our life. We are always talking about the war, about the amazing Nisim our family went through. It's hardly to believe what
miracles, just these miraculous.
Are miracles which are hardly to believe. And you know, we went one day for an education trip to the place where my father was born, and she made a diary about this trip. Unbelievable, so nice. And she is always speaking about the war. Nachon?
I don't know, always, but a lot, yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
Though we had the most beautiful childhood, and the memories to my grandparents and the family life are so, so beautiful and so precious. Yeah, the war was always amongst us.
It was always.
Though, because it's also in Holland, There's such a trauma, and as I told you, after Poland, Holland was the worst stricken country in Europe, with over 100,000 Jews who were taken away and murdered. So it was also my friends in school, and it's our history. It's our history. So we always kept on speaking about the war. And
look, my father, what a Chochmat Chaim he has got.
This is very typical for Opa. This is how Opa was being in his life. When I gave birth to my children, I have 6 sons, only boys, and by every boy, till he was, I think, 95, he came to every birth, to every breed, to come and to join.
One of my grandchildren is called after Benzion Moshkowitz.
My 4th child, we called Benzion Zacharia.
And that is this Moshkowitz who saved the life of my father. And look what a Simchat Chaim my father had. Always, you know, smiling. But during the night, he was always having a nightmare. He was shouting in his sleep.
And you remember?
Yeah, we were afraid of that. But during the day, he was laughing. He was always in a good mood. He was a very charming man. The ladies in the client were always crazy with my father. But during the night, He was a different person. He was always having nightmares of Buchenwald. Always. And we as children, we didn't understand it. Because in the night he was a completely other person.
One of my cousins, in his later, after my grandmother passed away in Yerushalayim, he went to Margret, to my second sister, and lived there till the end of his life. And he was, they took care of him wonderfully. And one of my cousins who slept the room next to Opa, I remember him saying on his levaya, Opa, you were the living example of lagit baboker chasdecha vemunatcha balelot. During the day, you were the most jolly, the most humorous, the most fun Opa, with jokes and laughing and singing and making jokes. But in the night, it was hell for you because I heard you
screaming,
but without you knowing that you were so afraid and you had such trauma and nightmares, but I heard, so that's
And you know, in Buchenwald, my father made a neder.
A vow.
If I survive this hell, the rest of my life I will dedicate to articles from fur for shoes. Look, this is one of the article he made for 7 shuls. He made a parochet from fur. He's the only one in the whole world who made from fur a parochet. If you are in the great shul in Yerushalayim, go and see what my father made. The most beautiful parochet from fur. And that was the neder he made in Buchenwald.
I think it's also in
Yeshurun. And there's 2 shuls here who have a parochet, and all the children, grandsons, great-grandsons got a bag for their talit and their tefillin, and he made for everyone. Everyone who was interested, he would show and would make for them,
And you know, unbelievable. While I was working in the community, I helped a lot of people, and when I started to collect money for Zichron Menachem, people like to give, you know, because I went to lonely people, to sick people, and they love to give something back. And for 6 years I was looking after an AIDS patient, a Jewish boy, a chosid, who was divorced and he left Yiddishkeit. He was off the derg. And when I visit him in hospital, he said, Dvora, help me, I want to do teshuva. I did everything what God forbid, and therefore I got AIDS. But please, can you help me? I said, okay, whatever you ask. So I gave him a house in Amsterdam. He was living out Amsterdam in a little town. We made a kosher household. I brought him a talis, tefillin, kosher food. He came sometimes for Shabbat in my house. And for 6 years, I always told him, look, Albert, if you do teshuva, one day, if you close your eyes, lamala, there will be
they will embrace you
because teshuva is very, very important. And he got much more ill and ill and ill, and one day he said, Dvora, finished, I can't anymore, I'm suffering so much, I'm ready to close my eyes, it's too much. And you know, he broke with all his family. He was a lonely boy. He said, but I want you to say Shema for me when it is so far. So I went there and he said to me, if I come, Lamala, I want to ask something for you because you were like a mother for me. What can I ask, Lamala? I said, a broche for my work for Zichron Menachem. And I tell you, and I believe in it, the moment Albert closed his eyes, I had muscle with my work. I, you know, You know, sometimes I'm in and then I don't know from where to do it, and it's so hard, and all these children who are dying, it's so depressing. And then sometimes I have a situation, I can't go on anymore, it's too much. And then I think about Albert, I think about the Brogge, and I go on. And then again something happens, and it's a must, you know. But I'm davening that one day they will find out a medicine, that my work is not necessary anymore, but it will take some more time, you know. So, maar wat ben ik vergeten?
Nou, that you were rewarded by the king, by the queen. The best friend of my mother, she's very, very close to my mother, and she was always so proud that she went in secret without us knowing. She went to the committee once a year. Nowadays it's a king, but his mother used to be the queen of the Netherlands, Beatrix. And it's a lot of work. You have to get all approvals papers. And papers from people who know the one who's trying to get, and it was accepted, and my mother got a reward from the queen, the former queen, Queen Beatrix, as for the reward of the work for the Zegomenachem, because it's such a beautiful fund.
And you know, yes. You know what is so amazing? I was working for 5 years in the hospice. This here in Amsterdam, a Jewish hospice. And I saw people who didn't believe in a God, who didn't do anything about religion. They had a struggle to close their eyes. And people who believe in HaKadosh Baruch Hu, they went away easily.
Quietly.
I learned that in the hospice, you know. Amazing how we believe in a world to come. So we are ready to die. And the people who didn't believe and was against religion, they had a very hard struggle.
Okay, I just want to take this opportunity to express my just being here in your presence is such an honor and a privilege, and meeting possibly the very youngest survivor of Ravensbrück, but not only meeting you, knowing your family, it's been such an honor and a privilege. And your story and your parents, I wish I would have met them, but your story is it's something that we can all not only learn from, but their example is just something the whole of the world should know, because their emunah, their faith, and what they went through. And I think your family, the Laffer family and the Moskowitz family, that they went through 3 camps, your family,
yeah.
Parents who were on the verge of death, and their 3 daughters surviving the war, and with the Moskowitz family, I think it's unique in this world. I don't know if there are any other stories like this.
It's mummish, amazing.
And not only that, Deborah, that your family remained religious, that they kept their emunah, their faith, is just unbelievable.
Yeah,
It is so remarkable. It is, they saw the worst, and they just kept their faith, and I think that's what kept them.
Yeah.
And your example that you survived for a reason, and what you're doing, the tzedakah you do, and what your family does, is we should all strive to emulate. I think it is, for me, coming to Amsterdam to meet you has been such a blessing, and I feel honored being here, really.
No, but I want to thank you, because you don't realize how important it is. We are the last generation. And soon, you know, there won't be any survivors. And the world should know about what happened. We have to continue every day again what a nissim we went through, and how important it is. And the lesson which I want to give to the next generation is, whatever tzoras will be in your life, always believe in a God, Lamala, there will always be an end of a tunnel. Nobody, there's everybody has some day, someday there will happen some tragedy. Everybody has got sorrows. We are not the only one, but never lose your emunah. That's what I want, a message to give to the next generation.
And you said something so beautiful that your daughters are your best friends.
My best friends. And I'm so proud of them because they have Chochmat Chaim. They are an example for me. I learn from them, you know? I learn from them how to deal in life. That's what I learned from them.
Shoshi, is there anything you would like to add?
Nothing. This has all been said. I mean, we've had such beautiful example and how to put like bitter and hard experiences to set that into positivity and into giving and to be radiant to the outer world. That's the best example I could have had. So what can I add?
I just want to all our listeners and whoever sees this, I know Zichron Menachem, I live in Beit Vegan as well, and it is one of the best causes one could ever be associated with. The work they do is just absolutely, it's pure chesed. It's just incredible how they've changed people's lives and eased people's lives. And you should just continue, and Hashem should give you the strength to continue, because it is so
it's
important.
So important. Can I give you some pictures of Zichron Menachem to put on the film? Look, the Machaneh starts by the Kotel. They are going to daven for a recovering of the illness and for a good end of the Machaneh. And then they come with an own flight, 200 people, you see? And here we make a trip in town.
On bicycles.
On bicycles. And in a boat trip. And for example, here we go on a bicycle with police in front and on the back. And the people who can't drive a bicycle, they sit in a
wheelchair. In the bicycle.
Yeah. Here, you know, I found a sponsor who gave money for presents to buy. Here, they do the most dangerous things, but the children, they want that. They want to be treated normal. They see that they are not the only one who is ill. And here, car riding.
The doctors are just amazed after they come back how the blood results are improved after
this girl lost a leg and she's playing beautifully piano. Here we went. Holland is beautiful, you know, as a country to have a holiday. It's amazing.
They dress up like farmers, Dutch farmers, and they go to the dolphins.
The dolphins, and you know, here
the most beautiful
place. Here we are davening mincha in the field. And here we had a barbecue.
Actually, this is the castle which the man promised to give. That he's the owner, he was the owner of that castle. So we stayed.
I got a present from the children. They gave me a special present. And you know, they take a mobile hospital because the treatment of the children, they go on. Here they are in a lift.
Je moet iets sneller gaan, want anders doet het allemaal op film.
Here, this is typical Dutch shoes. And
it's wonderful. Every page is a gem.
Yeah, here's Avram Fried giving a concert.
The last night I make always a concert from Avram Fried. They are, you know, getting crazy from him. And we made a balloon trip in the air. 6 balloons were with the children. Can you imagine? That was amazing. And here they go home, and the parents are, now here are the bus drivers. And here are the parents who bring the children back home, and they say that they have the, you know, there was a girl of 16, she was so ill that the doctors didn't know whether to take her or not. And by the concert of Avram Fried, Rotem, all of a sudden she stands up out of her wheelchair and she started to dance a little bit. But 2 months after the Machane, she died. And she said to her mother, the week in Holland was the most beautiful week in my whole life. 16 years. Then you know why you are doing it, you know. 16 years. And that week in Holland was the most beautiful week of her life. I can start crying again from that. Can you imagine? Yeah. And every time I hear this boy is Nebuch Nifter and that girl is Nifter, that's horrible.
But you ease their pain. You ease their pain and you gave them something that they looked so forward to.
Yeah, and you know, I feel privileged that I have the energy to do it. I thank HaKadosh Baruch Hu every day that I'm awake again, that I'm Bli Ayin Hara, I have the koyach to do it, because you need a lot of koyach to do this hard work, to save the money, to bring the children, to, you have no idea what the, I start a year before the Machane, I start working. Yeah.
So Dvori, you should just have all of Hashem's help, and we should all help, and you should continue in this such vital and important work that you do.
Yeah.